Lauren.
Hey, Jeff.
How are you?
I'm doing good. How about yourself?
Things are fantastic. Can you hear me okay? See me okay?
I can.
Awesome. So, got yourself a whiner.
I have got a dog that sounds like she's dying when visitors come over.
All right. And, well, let's talk about, it's two separate things, right? So, you want to fix your whining problem. But you also, it's keeping you back from dog training.
Yes, absolutely. So I reached out to Tara Seifring, who's here locally, and she helped me. She introduced me to the e-collar,
awesome.
Which I'm a huge advocate of now that I've seen the power behind it.
Awesome.
I am separating from the Air Force in May,
okay.
And I would love to open my own business, dog training.
Awesome.
And so when I have friends come over, I want my dogs to be an advocate for these tools so I can show them, hey, not only can I do this, but look, they work great and they're not these torture devices that people believe them to be.
Right.
Well, kind of the opposite is true. When they come over, instead it sounds like I have a dying hyena for a pet instead of a calm dog who stays in place.
Okay. So number one, two things. If you took the remote collars off, would your dog still be making the hyena-esque sounds?
No, but they would transition to jumping and licking the visitor instead.
Okay, so you can stop that without a remote collar.
Correct. Yes, I've watched your videos.
So
on that trip.
So you don't need to have a remote collar on your dog to stop the jumping and licking. Just reinforce the place command, which you can do without the remote.
Okay.
So the remote is not what's causing the whining. Most likely it's just the dog's energy, but so stop it without the remote if you want
okay.
to. So you don't need a remote for that. I mean, we use remotes for that all the time, but if you have an alternative way to do it, do it.
Okay.
Second of all, you don't need to prove anything to anybody, your friends. You don't need to prove that remote collars are fantastic to your friends that come to your house. Like, you have nothing to prove.
Sure, but it would be nice to have my own dogs as an advocate of the type of training I can accomplish.
I agree 100%. But you can do so much more with the remote collar besides this one thing, correct?
Correct, yeah.
Okay, so are you using your remote collar to do off-leash work with your dog, to do obedience work with your dog, to do other behavior modification?
Yes.
Okay, mm-hmm. Okay. So you're struggling with this one thing right now.
Yes, with this one dog. She is a constant challenge.
Okay, so let's put that aside for now.
Okay.
We'll get to it. If you don't fix this, are you going to still get into dog training?
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Good. So whether you fix it or not, you're still going to get into dog training. You're still going to do remote collar training, on and off leash training with clients, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you can still use this dog as a demo dog, whether it's whining or not.
Sure.
Are you just saying that just to appease me, or do you believe that?
I believe I could use her for a lot of other things.
Correct.
But, you know, it always makes a better impression if somebody comes to your house and you have two dogs who are calm and just observing.
Absolutely.
Rather than making it impossible for a conversation.
Absolutely. So.
But I do what you're saying.
So, but you can get your dog to go to place and hold place without a remote collar. Right?
Yes, but I would argue it's more difficult because I don't have a tie down. I don't have, you know, the ability to correct if she does pop off.
So you can make a tie down.
I could. The places that I keep their two elevated beds.
Yes.
You know, I'm not looking to tie down into the concrete floor or anything.
Okay. So do you have? Can you put them next to a door and you put a knot in the leash and then you put the leash through the door and you close the door?
Yes, I could do that.
You can do that. But also, there's like dogs stay in place without remote collars. That's just with repetition, and then correcting with your leash prong. So when a dog comes off place, if the dog already knows place, what does your correction look like?
So when she pops off, she gets the hot lava effect. So the floor is hot lava until she goes back to place.
With the remote. But how about if you don't have the
remote?
How about forget the remote, what would you do?
She has her leash on with the prong.
Okay.
It pops off. I go pick up the leash. I say, nope, put her back on, place.
Do you put her back on, or are you correcting with leash prong prior to putting her back on?
I am not giving a leash prong correction.
So you're keeping your dog in kindergarten.
Okay.
So your dog is acting like a kindergarten.
Okay.
So how long has your dog no place for?
A while, well over 2 months.
Okay, so.
Yeah, she's past that.
So leash on, prong on, dog comes off of place, say no first. Like immediately say no. So mark the behavior that the dog coming off of place is no. Walk up, always calmly, never, flustered, nice and calm, pick up the leash, correct. Firm.
Okay.
No emotion, no anger, no being pissed off. It's just matter of fact, I don't agree with you breaking a command that we've been working on for 2 months, and you know the dog knows it. So,
yes.
So pick up the leash, no, pop. Now, let's see what the dog does. Does the dog go back to place on its own? Or does the dog look at you like, well, what do you want me to do? I'd like to think the dog goes back to place on its own.
Then, yes.
So yep. Now the motivation to stay on place is two things. Well, let's just stick to one right now. It's you stay on place because so you don't want to get corrected. So there's a different couple of different ways we can do it, which is fine. Using that, the potential for a correction keeps a lot of dogs as well as human beings, in line. Especially on something that you've been busting your ass for 2 months for.
Right.
So what the missing link is, you're not correcting your dog for a known command.
Okay.
So let's forget the remote collar right now. Let's go back to leash prong work and see where we are.
Okay.
So now you have a dog that stays on place and doesn't whine, correct?
I would question the not whining portion.
Okay. It'll still whine.
Yes.
Okay. So then what you can do is, have you ever used a bonker?
I have for kennels.
Okay. Same thing. So mark it, no. Throw the bonker.
Okay. I never thought about that. Because when they're in the kennel, it hits the kennel. And I'm like,
This time it'll hit the dog, but it's a towel. So, you're not going to do any damage.
Sure.
You're not going to do any damage to your dog, So.
Sure.
So do that. So again, you've got to punish the act of whining, obviously. And then all of a sudden your dog goes, okay, I can't whine. So what happens is, so that's one way to do it. Which is what I would suggest, what I would say, give that 2 weeks of that. Okay?
Okay.
Now, when you are using the remote, I read through your bio, through your information, so you're doing low level continuous, you're doing high, you're doing all kinds of stuff. All right.
I have literally tried all possible combinations, I feel like.
When you go high, how high do you go?
I have not hit 100. But only because when I get up to 70, 80, it's not correcting anything.
No, I think that's a little bit high to stop whining. I think it's a little bit high to stop whining.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
So what is it? What are you using, the Mini Educator 300?
Yes.
Okay. So and you got a nice good fit on the dog?
Yes.
Okay.
She responds completely to all other commands. I just cannot find that sweet spot to
correct
this.
What's the dog's working level?
About a 2 or 3.
Okay. So what's happening is you're going way overboard on the whining, which is fine. It's not like you didn't damage your dog or mess up your dog. So what you need is I would stay under 30.
Okay.
And I would go lower levels, continuous, which is what you're probably already doing, but do the same technique, but not above 30.
Okay.
And
probably actually forcing that whine to continue.
Probably. But you didn't mess up your dog, because if you sent the dog to me and I never knew you went high, I would fix it. So it's not like you messed the dog up. Like, the dog is fine.
I'm not worried. She's acting perfectly fine.
Exactly.
Her vocal cords are definitely still working.
Exactly. So I would do that. So try that. So we've got two new game plans to work with. All right?
Okay.
Try that.
Got it.
Now, also, please don't let the pressure of your dog not being perfect stopping you. I just did if you watch actually today's free Skype again with Jessica, it's almost the same message that I put it up like 2 hours ago. It's the same message. Don't let some lack of perfection, which does not exist with your dog, keep you from doing incredible work with clients. Because how about if you could stop whining on 9 out of 10 client dogs? 8 out of 10 client dogs.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
While you're still working with your own.
Right.
Right? While you're still working with your own. So I have seen, I go to the gym and I see some personal trainers and I see them. They're not obese. I wouldn't even consider them like that overweight, but they're not in the best shape. But boy, their clients are killing it.
Yeah, and you know, using that exact metaphor, in my opinion, if I saw that, I would be like, man, that's a little hypocritical. You know, here they are telling me what to do, but obviously they can't do it themselves. And so I take that back and I'm like, well, that's probably what people are thinking.
Right. I just lost your video feed. There we go. But okay, so Mark Spitz's, okay, swim coach, didn't swim. But boy, was he a good coach, a good motivator, right? So, like, you don't have to have the perfect dog. I can give you probably 20 things that my dogs are either bad at or, like, horrific at that I help other people train better. So it's all about, you know, your job is a motivator and passing on knowledge and being a coach and being a therapist sometimes and being like, a supporter, an encouragement for other people. So yes, obviously you want to get your dog to stop whining. Absolutely. I'm not going to say keep your dog in a holding pattern, but what I want you to do is don't ever, ever, ever let it give you any self-doubt on your abilities with other dogs. You just might have a really, really difficult dog. And it's the same thing with aggression. I mean, I've had dogs that are highly aggressive that yes, we've made their lives better, but absolutely I've rehabbed probably dogs as client dogs better than these particular dogs. Now, is that a lacking of my ability? Is it a lacking of my time? Is it a lacking of maybe I didn't set the bar high enough for my own dogs? Or is it that I'm just like putting more effort into my clients than I am into my own personal dogs? Like, there's a lot of different variables there. I mean, if you can't walk your dog down the street, you shouldn't be a dog trainer. If you can't get your dog to, like, you know, do basic commands, I would be concerned. But sometimes on these little tiny things that you're still struggling with, you're going to do it at the same time as adding value to other people and helping them out.
Okay. That makes me feel a lot better, because I really, sometimes it made me doubt whether I can do it, because this dog is so difficult. Yep. And I'm like, well, shoot, if I can't fix these two that live with me, which really it's just one and part of their behavior, you know, it makes you wonder, well, can I actually handle what other people bring to me?
I think that you can, and I know that you can, and this is all part of your journey. This is part of your journey. This is part of your story. This is your motivation. This is why you maybe got interested in dog training, because of the journey of taking your dogs from, you know, point A to point B and your struggle. And you know what it feels like to struggle, and you want to be able to help other people with their struggle. So, like, it's all part of the journey. It's all part of the journey. But this concept of like dog trainers having these perfect dogs, like, really, I mean, it doesn't exist. And, you know, I mean, a great example is like Kira. Like, she does bite work. I didn't train her that. She does, I just work her. She does explosive detection. I didn't train her that. I just work her. She can jump off of trees. I didn't train her that. I'm making her better, but I just work her. So a lot of other people did the foundation work for some of my dogs. Well, for Kira specifically, I'm just working her, that one particular dog. I work on all her. Now, I trained her with her obedience, and I trained her with her off-leash skills, and I trained her with a lot of other stuff. But some of the stuff that gets the most visibility with her, somebody else that had specialized skills did all the work. Why? That's what they do for a living. And that's beyond my training, you know, knowledge. So,
right, right.
So don't worry about, like, don't worry about all that stuff. Don't worry.
Like, not being able to do everything.
Yeah, yeah. Don't. Yeah. I mean, that's why you're calling me. And other dog trainers call me. And I consult with other dog trainers on some of the stuff that I struggle with. Because if you're not willing to be, in my opinion, if you're not willing to be a student, you're not going to be a good teacher. So.
Yep, yeah, I agree.
Okay.
Do we have time left?
Not really, but go ahead.
Okay. Well, I was just curious if you thought, because she's very high energy.
Yes.
Do you think that is contributing to it? Like if I worked with her on, let's say, like treadmill or backpack during walks and decreased that amount of energy, you think that would, no? Okay. It's strictly just behavior?
I'm an absolute advocate of structured exercise and play and fun. But you can take your dog and you absolutely can have a dog that's high energy and turn the off switch on. I think you just have not figured out the formula yet.
Okay, perfect. That's what I wanted to know.
All right.
Perfect.
But yes, exercise your dog a ton. But also turn your dog off. Turn your dog off.
Sure.
All right?
Okay.
All right, Lauren.
All right, thank you. All right. I appreciate it.
All right, thanks for reaching out, Lauren. All right, bye-bye.